Good morning.
Good morning.
Small but mighty group. It's 10:02, so let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to gather. Lord, we pray that you would bless us as we seek to reach out to Billings and to areas around us and beyond. Continue to grace us with your presence and with growth and deepening of spiritual maturity. Lord, we pray that you would kindle in us a fire and then give us the encouragement and the power and the resources to go out and to do your will. All these things we ask in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Our opening hymn is Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Bound.
Thank you. Page three. Blessed be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to You all hearts are open, all desires known and from You no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of Your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love You and worthily magnify Your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ said. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. You want to say the word? Please join me with the glory.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to His people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship You, we give You thanks, we praise You for Your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, You take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For You alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The collect for the day. O God, we declare Your mighty power chiefly in showing mercy and pity. Grant us the fullness of Your grace, that we, running to obtain Your promises, may become partakers of the heavenly treasure. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives with You, lives and reigns with You in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Please be seated for the reading.
While Larry's coming up here, I'm going to give you your liturgical tip for the day. So occasionally we do read from the book of the apocryphal books of the Bible. So those are the books that were written in between the Old Testament and the New Testament. We do not regard them as holy scripture, but we regard them as writings that we can take knowledge from and that we can kind of gain some insight into what was going on during that time period. So today's first reading is from the Book of Wisdom. And typically what we do, normally when we do a reading, we say the word of the Lord, and then people say thanks be to God. When we do readings from the Apocrypha, we say here ends the reading, and the people don't say anything. So, there's your tip for the day. Take it away, Larry.
Book of Wisdom 12:13-16-19. But neither is there any God beside You. His care is for all. For Your strength is the source of righteousness, and Your sovereignty over all comes to You as peril. But You show Your strength when men doubt the completeness of Your power, and You rebuke any insolence among those who know it. Your sovereign in strength, that You judge with mildness, and with great forbearance You govern us, for You have power to act whenever You choose. Through such works You have taught Your people that the one who is righteous must be kind. You have filled Your son with good hope because You give Your patents for sin. Here in the reading.
On page 6, I'll read to the asterisk, and then we read to the second part. Bow down your ear, O Lord, and hear me, for I am poor and in misery. Preserve my life, for I am faithful.
My God, save Your servant, because of His trust in You.
Be merciful unto me, O Lord,
for I will call daily upon You.
Comfort the soul of Your servant.
For to You, O Lord, do I lift up my soul.
For You, Lord, are good and gracious.
and of great mercy to all those who call upon you.
Give ear, Lord, unto my prayer,
and attend to the voice of my humble supplications.
In the time of my trouble, I will call upon you.
For you answer me when I call.
Among the gods, there is none like you, O Lord,
nor are there any kings like yours.
All nations that you have made shall come and worship you, O Lord,
and shall glorify your name.
For you are great and do wondrous things.
Indeed, you are God alone.
Teach me your way, O Lord, and I will walk in your truth.
O Lord, give my heart to you, that I may fear your name.
I will thank you, O Lord my God, with all my heart,
and will praise your name forevermore.
For great is your mercy towards me.
You have delivered my daughter from the nethermost pit.
O God, the proud have risen up against me,
and the company of violent men have sought after my life, and have not set me before their eyes.
But you, O Lord God, are full of compassion and mercy,
long-suffering, plenteous in goodness and truth.
O turn then unto me, and have mercy upon me.
Give your strength unto your servant, and help the son of your handmaid.
Show me some token of your favor, that those who hate me may see it and be ashamed.
Because you, Lord, have been my help and comfort.
The New Testament reads Romans 8:18-25. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, and hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bonds to corruption and obtain the freedom and the glory of the children of God. And we know that the whole creation has been growing together from the pains of childbirth until now. Not only creation, but we ourselves, we have this fruit from Spirit, growing inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption of Son, the redemption of our lives. From this hope we are saved. Not hope that is seen is not hope, but we hope for what we see. But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the gospel. We will be singing Ancient Words. Verses 1, 2, and the chorus, and then 3, 4.
Saying, the kingdom of heaven can be compared to a man
who sowed seed in his field. But while his men were sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared also. And the servants of the master of the house came to him and said, Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have weeds? He said to them, an enemy has done this. So the servant said to him, then do you want us to go gather them? But he said, no, lest in gathering the weeds you uproot the wheat along with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And at the harvest, I will tell the reapers, gather the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn. All these things Jesus said to the crowd in parables. Indeed, he said, nothing to them without parable. This is the fulfillment of what was spoken by the prophet. I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter what has been hidden since the foundation of the world. Then he left the crowds and went to his house. And his disciples came to him, saying, explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field. He answered, the one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the Word, and the good seed is the sons of the kingdom. The weeds are the son of the evil one. And the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are gathered and burned in the fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all the causes of sin and all the lawbreakers, and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun at the kingdom of the Father. He who has ears, let him hear. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In different workplaces and things like that, there are inspirational posters, and they say, you know, inspirational things. There's actually a website that you can go to that has posters that are despairing, and that have like these, you know, negative comments. And I don't know if this is from the poster, but H.G. Wells said this. He said, man who began in a cave behind a windbreak will end well, in the end, die in the disease-soaked ruins of a slum. Kind of feels that way these days, doesn't it? It's hard to be encouraged, and it's hard to be excited because it looks like we're heading towards this disease-soaked ruins of a slum. And we've been talking quite a bit in Romans about this kind of in-between time, and that's where we are, and that's where we find ourselves today in terms of wearing masks and social distancing, but also in terms of Jesus' second coming. I'm ready for it. I don't know about you, but I'm ready for it. And this waiting becomes somewhat of a challenge sometimes. And so the scriptures today, we're gonna start with the gospel in Matthew, and we're just gonna look at that a little bit. And then we're going to jump over to Romans. And so, you know, what are our choices? How can we react to this end time, this in-between times, right? You know, the parable talks about being in a field and the good seeds, but the weeds are taking over. At least it seems that way to the good seed. And so what are our choices? Well, we could give up. We could despair. That's one choice. We could become complacent and deny that there are any weeds at all. We could try to take matters into our own hands and dominate. Or we could try to recognize the tension of the now but not yet and be discerning. Now, I'm going to step back for a minute, and I want you to appreciate the fact how hard it was to find four D's to talk about this. That's the hardest part of putting this sermon together. I want you to know that. So, we've got despair, we've got denial, we've got domination, we've got discernment. And those are essentially our choices and what we can do. Another way to put it is that we can groan too much and grin too little. Or we can grin too much and groan too little. And how do we find that balance? And so we're going to take a lesson from Paul, and we're going to focus not so much on the suffering, but on the glory. So Matthew 13 kind of addresses the reality of the world that we live in right now. But it also shows the promises of the future. And I'm not going to read the parable. You already heard it. The weeds that they talk about in that scripture, there's a Greek name for it. It's a real weed. Sometimes it was called darnel. It's also the word tares. You know, you've heard the wheat and the tares, right? So this is a weed that would grow up, and it would look very much like wheat until the harvest time when the fruit would come out, and you could be able to tell the difference. It was poisonous weed. It was definitely something you wanted to get rid of and not have in your wheat harvest. But it was a challenge to recognize. And as we hear in the parable, there's this kind of deliberate act of sabotage or maliciousness on the part of the evil one. He's coming in and he's purposefully planting these poisonous seeds in the garden. And again, because of the way they look, we need to let them grow together. So there's a few points just in this parable that I want you to kind of remember. Number one, we don't own the field. God does. It is not our field to tend in this parable, because in fact, we are the seeds. There's a very rare, I mean, we've been talking about this both ends kind of thing for a long time now, right? Well, you finally get your either or. You are either a good seed or you are a poisonous weed. Those are your two choices in this parable. There's no other choices. And in fact, along with that, you are either going to glory or you are going to be burned up. Either or. You finally get your either or, right? And it doesn't sound, it sounds a little scary, and it should be. Number three, we don't have anything to do with being the good seed. We are the good seed because God planted us there. The Father planted us. So again, our salvation has nothing to do with what we do. It has to do with what God does. And sometimes we forget that. Sometimes we think that, well, it's, you know, we're good seeds because of what we do and how we act. The fourth thing to remember is that there's some entanglement going on. In the parable, they talk about, well, if you pull up the weeds, you're going to pull up some of the good stuff too. And when we look at the world, there's entanglement going on. It's hard sometimes to be a Christian and not get entangled in some of what's going on in the world today. And we need to be careful with that. How do we do that? Well, we go back to the, if we follow the analogy, we're going to go back to the main root, to the tap root. Right? So is that love or hate? We can also put it another way, is that love or apathy? Because a lot of times I think we make that mistake instead of the other. Is it justice or is it injustice? Or again, is it justice or apathy? Is it mercy or vengeance? Is it mercy or apathy? The fifth point in this parable is that we're not quite ready to be harvested yet. There's still some fruit that needs to grow in us. There's still some development that needs to go on. The harvest is not yet. We're not mature. The last thing that I think we really need to take into account with this parable, and this is something that just came to me this morning, it's easy to look at this parable and intellectually kind of go, yeah, okay, I think I can kind of see that. The parable, you know, it's no big deal to have some weeds burned up in the furnace. It is a big deal that there are people out there that are going to go to hell. And this parable is striking in the either-or consequences of this. And we miss that sometimes. We get complacent. Yeah, it's okay that my neighbors don't know Jesus. No, it's not, because they're going to go to hell. We should be crushed by that. We should be energized by that. We should not be apathetic. Serious stuff. It's not just a story. Well, Romans, you know, if Matthew talks about kind of what the world is like right now, Romans talks about what we should be doing or feeling about that. And so Paul starts off, he says, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us." Paul is saying, you know what, we can't compare suffering and glory. In fact, we should probably contrast it. There's huge differences about what's going on there. This is kind of a response. If you guys remember the reading from last Sunday, it ended with Paul saying that we're fellow heirs with Christ, provided that we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. And so he's expanding on this, that yeah, we're going to suffer, but that suffering contrasted to the glory that's going to come is nothing. And then he kind of shifts from us and he goes to all of creation. And I love this. He says, "The creation waits with eager longing." And that word eager longing is going to appear three times in our scripture today. And it's kind of it literally means waiting with the head up. It's kind of like you're craning your head to see. You know, I think about when my daughter and grandson came to visit last year, and you're waiting in the airport, and you're just, is that them? Is that them? Because you're eager, and you're leaning forward, and you're leaning into it. I think we can also apply that to today. When is the day when I can take this mask off? I'm looking for that day, eagerly awaiting it. I'm leaning forward into it. And that's what Paul is talking about. The whole creation is doing that. It's eagerly anticipating the revealing of the sons of God. And then he goes on, he kind of goes back into history. And you remember, Paul has been contrasting Adam and Jesus throughout Romans. And here we go back to Genesis again. For creation was subject to futility. The word there is basically not being able to fulfill your purpose. Creation was not able to fulfill its purpose because of what Adam did. Because we messed up. And so because of that sin, there's this bondage that's going on, this bondage to corruption. We think about this bondage to decay, a bondage to death. The second law of thermodynamics, entropy, right? Everything goes from order to disorder. That's because of this. Someday that law is going to be reversed. Praise God. But so all of creation is looking for this. It's yearning for the time that it actually can fulfill its purpose. And it'll be set free from bondage, again, a theme that runs throughout Romans, and attain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. And he says, for we know that whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth. Y'all know Becky's, my daughter, is soon to deliver. She's going through some contractions now. They hurt. She's groaning, right? But there's a difference. Yeah, it is groaning in pain, but it's also groaning from the creation of new life. The creation is groaning, and we're groaning with it. In the pains of childbirth, that there is pain, but not despair. You're not groaning with despair. You're groaning with the anticipation and the pain that comes from new life. Paul says, we ourselves have the first fruits of the Spirit, and we groan inwardly. The only reason that we can do that is because we have the Holy Spirit. There's thousands of people out there that are quite content with the way things are. They may not be content with COVID, but they're quite content with life, the universe, and everything. Because it takes the Holy Spirit to actually help us recognize that we're in a field of weeds. And that as a consequence of that, we start groaning as well. In anticipation of that day when we will be delivered from that. Again, there's that word, we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. Now, again, we have been adopted as sons, right? I mean, we are children of God, and yet we're still waiting for that final completion of that time, when we are resurrected, when our bodies are redeemed. And then I love this, he says, for in this hope we were saved. Now that doesn't mean that we are saved by hope, because we're saved by faith, through grace, right? But part of salvation for us today includes hope. We were in Amazing Grace on the travel. The Lord has promised good to me, his word my hope secures. Yeah, God has promised good to us. He's promised that there will come a time when Jesus returns. And all tears are wiped away, but that hasn't come yet. But that promise secures our hope. It's not a hope of, gee, I wish. It's a secure hope. Do you see that? It's a hope that we know that we know that we know that this is going to happen. Then he goes on and he talks about that hope. And he says, we hope for what we do not see. We wait for it with patience. Now, there's that eagerly wait. It doesn't say that, but it's the same word. We eagerly wait. We're praying on his part. But we're doing it with patience. I mean, talk about tension, right? We have this eager desire, and yet we're patient. So that means two things. It means don't lose your patience. but don't lose your eagerness as well. Find that balance. It's hard to do sometimes. So how do we discern what to do and where we are? So first of all, I would suggest you need to recognize your condition in the field. Because you're either a good seed or you're a weed. And before you can do anything else, you kind of need to get yourself right with Jesus. So if you're not sure about that, come and talk to me. Come and talk to your online, find a priest or a pastor or a friend who's a Christian to talk to about that. So that's the first thing. Recognize your own place in that field. Next, we need to recognize the condition of the field. Again, it's really easy to just ignore our neighbors. To ignore the fact, I mean, think about this parable, if you will. Here's, 15 good seed wheats growing up. What about the person in that house? What about the person in that house? What about the person that just drove by? What about the people that were walking their dogs? The condition of the field. We need to recognize that. Because until we recognize that, we're not going to want to do anything about it. Next thing is we need to recognize that God has a plan. God is God and I am not, and that's a good thing. I say that every day. God has a plan. He doesn't have a plan B because he doesn't need one. And so we need to recognize that, again, his plan involves not doing the harvest right now, as much as we might desire that. But his plan also involves us being a part of the harvest. And that, of course, is a different parable, but nevertheless, we need to be a part of what's going on in God's kingdom. How do we recognize God's plan? Well, I would suggest to you scripture and prayer and fellowship with other Christians. And as you read God's word and as you pray about God's word and as you talk about God's word, you'll be able to discern what God's plan is, not just the big picture plan, but his plan for you as well. And so then, you can start looking for ways to engage the field. To maybe make a difference in terms of that. And what Paul is saying is that while we do all of this, while we look at ourselves, while we look at the field, while we look at others, while we figure out what God is calling us to do, we need to do that from the lens, not of suffering, but of glory. Because we know how the story ends. We win. Because God wins. And because we are children of God, adopted through Jesus Christ. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that we can rejoice in the midst of pain, anxiety, fear, death. Thank you that we can rejoice, not in those, but in knowing that there will be a time when those are gone. That there will be a time when we will be complete, where all of creation will be fulfilled in its purpose of glorifying you. Thank you that we can be a part of that. That you work in us and through us for your glory. And so, Lord, we offer ourselves to you, that you would work in us and through us, that we might do your kingdom work in Billings, in our neighborhoods, in our families, and beyond, for your glory. And all these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us stand and face the cross of Christ and confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
Father and Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being of the Father. Through him all things were made. For us are our salvation. He came down from heaven. He was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and then was made man. For our sake, he was crucified by the righteous Father. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in order to the churches. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let's pray for the church and for the world. Almighty and ever-living God, you have taught us by your holy word to offer prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all people. We humbly ask you to mercifully receive our prayers. Inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. And grant that all who confess your holy name may agree in the truth of your holy word and live in unity and godly love.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray that you will lead the nations of the world in the way of righteousness, and so guide and direct our leaders, especially Donald, our president, that your people may enjoy the blessings of freedom and peace. Grant that our leaders may impartially administer justice, uphold integrity and truth, restrain wickedness and vice, and protect true religion and virtue. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Give grace, Heavenly Father, to all bishops, priests, and deacons, especially to your servants, Foley, our Archbishop, Keith, our Bishop, John, our priest, and Gretchen, our deacon, that by their life of teaching they may proclaim your true and life-giving word, and rightly and duly administer your holy sacraments. And to all your people give your heavenly grace, especially to this congregation, that with reverent and obedient hearts we may hear and receive your holy words, serving you in holiness and righteousness all the days of our lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Prosper, we pray, all those who proclaim the gospel of your kingdom throughout the world, and strengthen us to fulfill your great commission, making disciples of all nations, baptizing them and teaching them to obey all that you have commanded. Lord, in your mercy,
we remember before you all the servants who are part of this life and your faith and fear, especially the great attacker and John Lewis, that you know for them and be fulfilled. We ask you to give us grace to follow this man, all your saints, that we may share with them and what you think. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. We pray especially today for those who are sick and suffering and not with us. We pray for Donna Anderson, Glenn, Margie, Everett, Aaron, Doug, Becky, Jim, Doris, Duncan, Leanne, Jill, Gretchen, Jay, Luke, Nancy, Allison, Ava, Marlene, Corey, and those you now name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We commend your gracious care in keeping all the men and women of our armed forces and first responders at home and abroad. Defend them day by day with your heavenly grace. Strengthen them in their trials and temptations. Give them courage to face the perils which beset them, and grant them a sense of your abiding presence wherever they may be. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, grant these our prayers for the sake of Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry that we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. The glory of your name.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in His great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to Him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And hear the word of God to all who truly turn to Him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Greet one another with peace from a distance. Peace, everybody online. Hymn this morning is Breathe on Me, Breath of God. Thank you. Continuing on the bottom of page 8. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. All things come from you, O Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Try that again. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right. Our duty and our joy always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy,
holy, holy, Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had sinned against you and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, into the world for our salvation. By the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, he became flesh and dwelt among us. In obedience to your will, he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death we might be saved. By his resurrection he broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under his feet. And as our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory, that we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. And we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your word and Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Sanctify us also that we might worthily receive this holy sacrament and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us, and we in him. And in the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us with all your saints into the joy of your heavenly kingdom, where we shall see our Lord face to face. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
Together. We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord.
Trust in our own righteousness,
fit in your abundant and great mercy. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table. But you are the same Lord, whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord,
So eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Grant us your peace.
These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. Please be seated and tell your Lord. Post-communion hymn is "I Want to Walk as a Child of Light."
I want to walk as a child of light.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated for a few announcements. So thank you for your prayers as I traveled, for Margie. Margie is doing well. She did have some kind of virus, but it wasn't the virus, so that's good. She still has a little bit of a cough. She didn't want to expose anybody to that, which is why she's not here today. But she's doing a lot better. And the trip, coming back at least, was fun with her. There will be Bible study this Wednesday. As we continue in Lamentations. I'm not going to do the Anglican way after service today just because we're missing people. But what I will do is just kind of ask the priest. So if you have any questions, did Adam and Eve have a navel? Important theological things like that, just stick around afterwards and we'll try to answer those. Next week, I'm going to try to do the horse thing that I was going to do last week. So Father David is going to come and he's going to celebrate and preach for us. When he comes, you can call him Dr. David because he's got his doctor of ministry done. So he's got a doctor of ministry in biblical counseling now. So he's Dr. Father David. Yes. Tomorrow morning, no morning prayer because I have an appointment at the PA. Nothing urgent, just a regular checkup. And then lastly, people have been asking about getting some new cards for the church, so we have those. They're on the table back there. It says Holy Spirit Anglican Church gives our website, gives my name, the administrator email, talks about where we meet on the back, our vision being a community that just deepens relationships by loving God and loving others. There's a space on there where you can write your name and contact information. So grab a bunch of those and hand them out. And let's spread the word. Any other announcements? Good. You did? Oh, so they didn't pray for you last week?
Nope.
Well, I mean, I'll
have an announcement, though.
Okay.
You all remember that we prayed for Luke, the young man with the acute. He had 5 continuous weeks of chemotherapy. And his bone marrow is now clear. He is going in for 3 days for another 5 weeks for another round of chemotherapy, but he's doing well.
So Jim had a birthday. Do you want to share how old you are?
75.
75. Awesome. We don't ask the women that. We just ask the men.
We're proud to do it. We got to live with women.
So please lift your hearts and your hands. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Jim's birth, for the life that he has led. We pray that you would continue to bless him with life abundantly, that he would continue to be your servant, and that you would continue to work in him and through him. All these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Any other birthdays or anniversaries? Anybody traveling besides everybody who's already gone? Let's lift them up. Heavenly Father, thank you for the ability to travel. We pray for all those who are camping and visiting relatives, and we pray for their safe return as they come back on the roads. We pray for safe travel. We pray for opportunities for them to share your life and goodness. In Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing hymn is Old for a Thousand Times. Thank you.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.